Arlene is still up there. Good morning, everyone. Welcome. So what did one tectonic plate say to the other when it bumped into it? Sorry, my fault. And I would tell you a joke about the upcoming eclipse, but I'm going to wait till tomorrow so I can brighten your day. Miss Roxanne Miller is going to start us off with an announcement. Just want to say, y'all keep encouraging me, so I'm not going to stop.
Okay. So stop it. Don't encourage her.
Yeah, you did.
So this should be the last Sunday, so Mr. Allcamp tells me that you will have to see my face, and good morning to everybody. We do have some Easter eggs left and some supplies. We really want to unload them, so come see us if you're interested, because we'll work out a deal. And we will be up there after the church service. Hope to see you.
We have a bunch of announcements this morning, so I'm going to try to rattle them off. Circle of Friends is meeting April 16th. Talk to Jeanette Minnick if you're interested. April 18th, Genesis Preschool is hosting a pop-up meal from Salute. So check the Join Us This Sunday email or my email, or call and ask about it to figure out how to do that. You have an insert in your bulletin this morning. We are doing our second annual Spring Fling and Art Show, which is a joint event with Genesis Preschool on May 5th. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. We're going to invite the preschool here for worship on Sunday. And then go out, there's going to be food trucks, a bounce house, lots of carnival games. If you want to hang out and help, please let me know. If you want to just come and enjoy, do that also. On the back of that announcement, there's another one. For that day, the serve team is collecting items for a hygiene kit to be put together during the event. So if you can donate any of those items, but on or before May 5th, that would be very exciting for the serve team. There is our next men's breakfast is happening at the Red Plate Diner this Thursday at 9 a.m. Please RSVP to Jerry Stump if you are able to go. We are going to have a community meal on April 25th in the Fellowship Hall. Look for more information to come, and please join us. It's free and open to the public, so invite your friends. DVS is coming really, really fast. It's the second full week in July. Vacation Bible School. Sorry, Jeff said I shouldn't abbreviate. So Vacation Bible School is coming very quickly. This Tuesday at 6:30, we're going to do a Zoom conversation. If you have any interest in figuring out how to help during VBS, the week of, in planning for, please let me know if you need that Zoom link. We could really use your help this year. Please sign your pew pads. Please take your bulletins home to remind you of all these amazing things that are happening here at St. John's, because there's a lot going on. All right, I think that's it. In our prayers this morning, Sylvie Pugh, who is Arlene and Leon's daughter, Kendra's daughter, she's the one who was born with heart problems, had a second seizure this past week. So we're keeping Sylvie and her parents in our prayers. Jeanette Minnick is having a medical procedure on Tuesday, so we're keeping Jeanette in our prayers. And Diane Lajato is having a spinal fusion surgery on Thursday. So we're keeping her in our prayers. Are there any other prayer requests for the good of the group? Oh, I will say that Judy Houck, Chris Waronko's mom, who has been in the hospital and then in rehab, got to come home on Wednesday. We're very excited about that. Amen. All right. Well, it's wonderful to be with you all this morning, and we will begin with the prelude. Oh, and children can head out to Children's Chapel. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the wellspring of grace, our Easter and our joy.
Amen. Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
Immersed in the promises of baptism, let us give thanks for what God has done for us. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your voice thundered over the deepened water, became the essence of life. Adam and Eve beheld Eden's verdant rivers. The ark carried your creation through the flood into a new day. Miriam led the dancing as your people passed through the sea into freedom's land. In a desert pool, the Ethiopian official entered your boundless baptismal life. Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
At the river, your beloved son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you opened the floodgates of your reconciling love, freeing us to live as Easter people. We rejoice with glad hearts, giving all honor and praise to you through the risen Christ, our source of living water, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Look, here is water.
Here is our water of life. Hallelujah.
The love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is from the fourth chapter of Acts, beginning at the 32nd verse. Now the whole group of those who believed were the one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, let us read responsively from Psalm 133. How good and how pleasant it is. It is like fine oil upon the head, flowing down upon the beard.
Upon the beard barren, flowing down upon the collar of his robe.
It is like the dew of Hermon, flowing down upon the hills of Zion.
For there the Lord has commanded the blessing, life forevermore.
The second reading is from John 1, beginning at the first verse. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands. Concerning the word of life, this life was revealed, and we have seen it and testify to it and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you may also have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus his Son cleanses us from our sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. What a joyous time of year we are in, the season of Easter, the most joyous time in the church year. A season in which we declare Christ indeed has risen from the dead. Victory over death in the grave is his, and it's ours too. But remember what we heard in last week's gospel, that the women, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome, went to the tomb with spices to prepare Jesus' body for a proper burial. As they went along, they were worried about the large stone that blocked the entrance to the tomb and who might help them roll it away. But when they got there, they found that the stone had already been moved. And when they went inside, they find a young man in a white robe who tells them plainly that Jesus is not here. He has been raised. And how did they respond to that joyful news? Fear. They were frozen by fear. Froze them right in their tracks. So afraid that they told no one about one of, if not the most important event in human history. I wonder what might have been going through their minds in that moment. Did they doubt the young man in the white robe who told them about Jesus being raised from the dead? Quite possibly, I think. We find much of the same in today's gospel lesson. Now, it would be easy for me to jump to Thomas, poor Thomas, doubting Thomas, we call him. For whatever reason, he was not with the other disciples the first time they saw the risen Christ. So he heard a secondhand account of the resurrection, and he struggles to believe what the disciples had told him. Thomas simply wants to see for himself what the others have already seen for themselves. Remember, it was after Jesus showed the others his hands and his side that they rejoiced. And frankly, I think if I were in Thomas's shoes, I'd want to see for myself too. But because he asked to see before he would believe, he's been touted with this moniker, Doubting Thomas. And I think that's a little unfair. So let's set the scene. In the evening of that first day when Christ rose from the grave, the evening of that first Easter morning, the disciples were gathered in a locked room. Locked. For, as the scripture tells us, for fear of the Jews. You might expect that the disciples would be celebrating at this point, but instead they are huddled behind locked doors. Why were they so afraid? Simply because they thought what happened to Jesus might happen to them too. In one commentary I read, it suggested that maybe the disciples were afraid of Jesus himself. After all, look at how the disciples behaved. He Peter denied even knowing Jesus, not once, but three times. Most of the others were nowhere to be found. The only one who we know was at the cross was the one identified as the disciple that Jesus loved. Everyone else was cowering in fear. So maybe the last person they wanted to see that first Easter evening was Jesus. I mean, risen from the dead. Probably, in their minds, ready to confront them with their failures. So it might make sense that they were afraid of the risen Christ. Afraid that he would tell them how disappointed he was with them and in them. Afraid he would call them out for not believing what he had been telling them throughout his ministry, that he would be handed over, crucified, then rise to new life on the third day. Jesus said that repeatedly. And now it's happened, just as he promised. And here they are, cowering in fear. But what happens is very much the opposite of what the disciples might have expected. Jesus did not chastise them. He brings them a message of peace. The first words he speaks to those who abandoned him was, "Peace be with you." And then he showed them his hands and his side, saying effectively, "Yeah, it's really me. It is me. I did what I told you. Yeah, I'm the one that they hung on the cross, but here I am, back just as I promised." But what he does next is what I find to be the golden nugget of this text. What does he do with these people that he has every right to be disappointed in, let down by? There is not one word of criticism, quite the opposite. He commissions them. He tells them, "As the Father has sent me, so I send you." This unlikely, fearful bunch are now entrusted to bring God's message of love and hope and redemption out into the world. These cowering, fearful, doubting people. Here, Jesus empowers them to go out into the world and continue his mission, revealing God's love to a world in need. And it gets even better. He breathes on them and tells them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Jesus is effectively handing over the keys to the church to the ones that he continues to believe in, even though in that moment they had so many doubts themselves. And Thomas is included as one of the ones sent out. It's a story of great faith. We often think of faith as something that we have, faith in God, faith in Jesus, faith in the Holy Spirit. But here we are reminded that faith is a two-way street, that God in Christ has faith in you and me. We are partners with Christ. Today's scripture makes that clear. Faith that despite our fears and our doubts, send us out into a world in need to spread the good news of God's love for all of God's people and to build his church. The church, yes, 2,000 years later, is still being built. A church that began with people cowering in fear even after seeing the resurrected Christ. Fear and anxiety have always been a part of the church, and it continues, as we know, to be true today. We've struggled, and in many ways we continue to struggle, to be the church in a post-pandemic world. We mourn what we've lost. Fewer people in our pews, fewer volunteers, fewer financial resources. The list of losses goes on and on. We struggle, too, to figure out how to live out the gospel at a time where, in our country, for example, we are so divided, more divided than any time that I can recall in my lifetime. We're divided politically. We're divided economically. We're divided socially. The natural thing to do when you feel anxious is to hunker down. Lock the doors like the first disciples did, rather than take on the risky mission that we're called to do. The promise of this text is that despite our fears and worries and our doubts, to unlock our doors, to venture out, that Jesus has a mission in the world today, just as he did 2,000 years ago. A mission that cannot and should not ever be stopped because of our fears. Jesus comes to us just like he did those first disciples, right in the midst of our fears and doubts. He comes to us with the words, "Peace be with you," breathing on our anxious bodies the power of the Holy Spirit. Jesus keeps showing up, not because of us, sometimes in spite of us, right here in this place, in many ways. In the Holy Spirit, in bread and wine, which become for us the body and blood of Jesus. His holy presence is with us in this place, and we take it with us outside these doors. Jesus continues to have faith in us and continues to work through us, sending us out, as challenging as it is, out of our safe, locked rooms into a world that needs us, that needs him, that needs us to share his gifts of life and love and peace and freedom and redemption. The future of our church depends on us moving from fear to faith and living out our calling to go and make disciples, key word being go, to leave this place, bringing Christ right along with us. The mission of the church has not changed one bit over the last 2,000 years. We are called to move beyond ourselves, beyond our worries, beyond our fears and doubt, and to show God's love by supporting Christ's mission in the world and living lives of faith, not fear. Peace be with you. Amen.
Morning. Good. You all seem a little low on energy today. You are energetic. Fantastic. Abby's energetic for us. Did you all feel that earthquake earlier this week? No? Did anybody hear it? Yeah, it was really weird. There was an earthquake. And do you know what's happening tomorrow? Solar eclipse. Yeah. Yeah. What? What do the sun and the moon do? They come together, right. So the moon is going to overshadow the sun and it's going to make it dark in the middle of the day. No, they will not explode. They won't actually touch. Thank goodness, because if they did, we would be in a world of trouble. We would be meeting Jesus tomorrow. Everybody. So, what did you do in Children's Chapel this morning? Can you show everybody? Because they are beautiful. And what are those? Yeah, they're hands. What, Abby? Right, so they're hands. Did you trace your hands?
Yeah.
Yeah, you traced your hands and you drew the holes where Jesus would have been nailed to the cross in his hands. Wow, that's pretty powerful stuff. And what did you write at the top? Josh, do you want to share what you wrote?
I believe.
Wow. Do you believe that Jesus was hung on a cross?
Yeah.
Is that always easy to believe?
No.
No, why not? Yeah. So people shouldn't have done that, but they did. It's not something that happens nowadays, right? Thank God for that. But right, so it's hard to believe because it's not a practice we're used to. Why else is it hard to believe? What do you think, Brian? Why do you think it's hard to believe sometimes? Oh, it's hard to believe that people would do that to other people. Yeah, it hurts my heart for sure, yeah. Because it happened a long time ago. We didn't actually get to see it. Sometimes it's really hard to believe things that we can't see. And that was true for the disciples who knew Jesus, and especially for Thomas. You guys heard of doubting Thomas? Yeah, poor guy, right? Right, he didn't believe it. It was hard to believe. Right, he said he wouldn't believe it until he actually saw Jesus and touched his hands and his side. So I'm going to ask you to come up here around the baptismal font. We're going to do a little experiment. All right, Liam. Oh, no. I love that. So I gave Liam a paperclip. You want to show everybody the paperclip, okay? What's going to happen when you drop that paperclip in the font? It's going to sink. All right, let's see. Test your hypothesis. Yeah, well, it sank, right? Can you fish that out for me, please? All right. So, Josh, I now have a little piece of paper towel. And you all are going to have to trust that this is happening. But, Josh, would you mind just gently laying that paper towel on the top of the water? Because do you believe that I could make that paper towel float? Or that paper clip float? Yeah? All right. So, Liam, now I'm going to ask you to hold the paperclip like this and very gently just drop it right on that paper towel, the same direction that it's going, okay? All right. Woo, it's sitting on the paper towel, which makes sense. It's like floating on the paper towel. It's still on the paper towel. But what's happening to the paper towel? The paper towel is sinking. And what's happening to the paperclip? It's floating! I know you can't necessarily believe us, but it's actually happening. And we're going to be very gentle, and we're actually not going to play in the water today to see how long we can keep that floating. But it is floating, right? Would you have believed that I could make a paperclip float? What? Would you like to come up here and see? Jeff feels like doubting Thomas. If you don't believe the pastor, all right, so here. I knew I was going to do that. We actually have a second bowl of water. So Josh, can you take this for me and just stick it on the rail right there? Okay. And then we're going to have you guys step a little bit away. I know not everybody will be able to see the bowl, but it's there. And I have a second paperclip. Yes, can you hold the paperclip? And Briar, can you put the paper towel in the bowl very gently? Just lay it right on top of the water. I just came well prepared today because I knew we would have people who doubt. All right, very gently, yep. Okay, now step back so we can see if maybe people can see that there's, here, come this way, Briar. There's a piece of paper towel, and in a moment, it's going to sink. It's happening. There it goes. And yet, the paper clip is floating. So I know it's still really hard to see. But that paper clip is still floating. So, oh, thank you very much. And I'm just going to keep dropping everything. From the story of my week. So, that's pretty amazing, isn't it? Sometimes things are hard to believe, and I bet we still have some skeptics here, some people who are struggling to believe that our paper clips are floating. But we are called to believe. Jesus has faith in us so that we can have faith in Jesus, and we can go out into the world with this faith, even if it's sometimes hard to believe. And we can share God's love with the world. And how do we do that? By showing people that paper clips float? No. How do we do it, Andy? So by telling people about Jesus, maybe, and helping them believe in Jesus, and that they should believe it too? How else do we share God's love with people? Yeah. The Bible. We can help them read the Bible. Yep. How do we share God's love? Can we be nice to people?
Yes.
Yeah. Can we smile at people?
Yes.
Can we help people when they need help?
Yes.
Yeah. We can do all of those things. Okay? So, when you look at these beautiful pictures that you have made, and I hope you put them somewhere that you can see them every day, and you wake up and you can know that God loves you so much, and you can be helped to believe. But when it's difficult to believe, just know that God loves you. All right? How about we pray together? Loving God, we thank you for believing in us and for giving us the gift of faith. We ask that you help us to wake up each day knowing how much we are loved so that we can go forth and show everyone else how much they are loved by you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thanks for coming up. Do you want to grab your picture?
I can replicate the experiment after for anyone who doesn't know.
All right, I invite you to please rise in body or spirit so we can confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rejoicing that Jesus is risen, and love has triumphed over fear. Let us pray for the church, the world, and all those in need of good news. Your church cries out, O God, and you listen. As you drew near to the disciples, draw near to us this day. Breathe on us, your Holy Spirit, that our faith is renewed and we witness to your love. God of grace, hear our prayer. Your creation cries out, O God, and you listen. Nurture trees, crops, wildflowers, and all growing things. Guide farmers, gardeners, arborists, and others who tend the soil and nurture plants into life. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your world cries out, O God, and you listen. Guide police, firefighters, paramedics, and other first responders to work for the well-being of communities and the dignity of every person, that no one may need to live in fear. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your children cry out, O God, and you listen. Hear your people crying out for justice, for an end to racism and other oppression, and for a world where all are fed and safe. We pray for all who cry out in suffering or pain, especially Sylvie, Kendra, Ryan, Jeanette, Diane, and Judy. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Your congregations cry out, O God, and you listen. Renew pastors, deacons, musicians, and other staff, administrators and volunteers who facilitated Holy Week and Easter worship. Open our hearts to discern where God calls each of us to serve. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Accept our gratitude, O God, for the lives of those who now rest in you. Grant us your peace amid our fears. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, most merciful God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your abiding love through Jesus Christ, our resurrected and living Lord. Amen.
And now may the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
We share our time to meet with one another.
O Lord, we give you thanks for your love of all creation. Today you give us a new commandment to love one another as you have loved us. Give us the strength and will to live out this commandment by serving a world in need with acts of kindness and compassion. Amen.
Transcend you.
Together we pray our offertory prayer. Risen One, you call us to believe and bear fruit. May the gifts that we offer here be signs of your abiding love. Form us to be your witnesses in the world through Jesus Christ, our true vine. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God. You reveal your glory as the glory of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, equal in majesty, undivided in splendor, one Lord, one God, ever to be adored in your eternal glory. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. At Jesus' table, heaven and earth are joined as one. Come and see. Please be seated.
God, you take away the sin of the world. Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Go in peace. Please stand in body or spirit. As together we say the prayer after communion. Shepherding God, you have prepared a table before us and nourished us with your love. Send us forth from this banquet to proclaim your goodness and share the abundant mercy of Jesus, our Redeemer and friend. Amen. And now be sent out with God's blessing. Hallelujah, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
The God of resurrection power, the Christ of unending joy, and the Spirit of Easter hope, bless you now and always. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Disciples, go in peace. Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And if you want to see the experiment, it'll be over here.